I want to just welcome everyone to our Black History Month, a presentation on social justice. Before we hear from Dr. George White, I wanted to give an opportunity. Well, let me first start off by saying that this presentation is being recorded. So I want to let everyone know that. And then there's a button at the bottom of your screen that says live transcripts. So if you want to click on that button, and Diane, if I'm saying something that's not there, please help me out, but please do that. So I wanted to let everyone know that. So before we get started with the presentation, I wanted to give Diana Kramer, the Interim Chief of Staff, an opportunity to give a welcome for President Daisy Coco de Filipis, who will not be able to join us today. Diana.
Thank you so much, Vice President Yates, and thank you for offering us the opportunity to join this incredibly timely conversation. And I'd like to welcome your guest, Dr. George White, from our fellow sister institution. I'm very much looking forward to what he has to say. And on behalf of the president, I'd like to share with you some words on her thoughts on Black History Month. And so as many of us know, February is Black History Month, which affords us all the opportunity to reflect on and to honor the many by African Americans over the course of our nation's history. Those contributions cover every conceivable field, activity, and discipline, from science to government, from the arts to economics, from agriculture to astrophysics and beyond. Black Americans have distinguished themselves. Their ideas, inventions, and actions have enriched this country and the world. Lamentably, their achievements have too often been written out of the history books or credit for them taken by others. To redress the historical record and make proper attribution of these accomplishments is one of Black History Month's goals. It also offers us a time for somber reflection on the systemic racism which has marred and continues to mar so many lives, destroyed so much potential, hurt, and enraged so many. We mourn the toll that prejudice and bigotry have taken over the centuries, just as we join in the celebration of Black America's determination to overcome hatred and oppression. It is a time to reaffirm our commitment to making life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness something every citizen can pursue on an equal footing. And as Black History Month has gotten underway here at OSTOS, we have pledged our whole hearts to ensuring the dignity of all through multiple activities here hosted from the Office of the President, as well as through faculty in the Black Studies Unit, and now in partnership with yourself, Vice President Yates, and the faculty and the staff of the Student Development and Enrollment Management Division. We are so grateful to partner with colleagues on these endeavors. And we also wish to say that although February is coming to a close, the good work here at OSTOS does not end. We will be continuing with our Black at OSTOS series with functions and town halls being held in March and in April. And we look forward to others coming forward with ideas to share to generate future activities in support of our colleagues and our community. And I know Dr. White has a full presentation ahead of him, so I will stop here and just thank everyone so much for putting this together and for offering this opportunity. Thank you.
Excellent. So before I bring in Dr. White, Albagina, is it possible to play the video first and then I'll do a brief introduction of Dr. White and then the floor is his.
So I can't get around it.
So low, you can't get under it.
To dance our way out of our constriction. Gonna be freaking up and down the hang-up alleyway. With the groove I only got, we shall all be moved. Ready or not, here we come. Getting down on the one which we believe in.
Can I get it on my good foot? Good God. About time I got down on the end.
We're on the move.
Hey, don't tell me now.
Can you move?
you're talking for? Don't tell me now. Do you promise the funk? The whole funk, nothing but the funk.
Dr. White is an author, professor, and the interim dean for the School of Arts and Sciences at York College of the City University of New York. Dr. White's first book, Holding the Line, Race, Racism, and American Foreign Policy Toward Africa, 1953 to 1961, was published in 2005. His second book will be an edited volume of the papers of a World War II chaplain entitled On the Battlefield for My Lord, the papers of Reverend Robert Boston Doakes in World War II. In addition of his PhD, Dr. White also has a JD from Harvard Law School and has taught courses on portions of courses on the impact of the American legal system on society. I would like to introduce Dr. George White, not only a colleague of mine when I was at York College, but someone I consider a friend. So Dr. White, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Latour. I appreciate that very warm introduction and so glad that, to see you again. I know that you're going to be an asset to HOSOS and really hold it down for all of us. So thank you. Thank you for inviting me. And thanks to Lillian and Elba and the whole team for inviting me to do this presentation. I really appreciate this. I'm going to share my screen so that I can start with PowerPoints. And wanted to kind of walk through the challenges of social justice in our time through popular culture, through music, and particularly through a kind of comparison or contrast between R&B and funk on the one hand and hip hop on the other hand, which I do a lot in my classes and really enjoy. The title of this presentation is taken from a blog post that I wrote almost 2 years ago, and I'll read some of that once we get into it. But it's derived from the song that, you know, Elba was trying to play. I sent her the link, and maybe my link was corrupted, so I apologize. But it's this song, One Nation Under a Groove, by the group Parliament. And I thought that this was appropriate in June 2020 when I wrote the blog post as a way of talking about the multiracial, very inclusive protest that took place during that Breonna Taylor, George Floyd summer. So I thought it was really, really appropriate. And I was hoping to play the music. I thought I had embedded it in my PowerPoint, but it's not working. So I was asking Elba if she could maybe do a brother a solid. But I even without the music, I mean, this song is really, really important and kind of breathtaking in a lot of ways. And instead of just focusing on the song, then let's look at the album cover. And I'm just curious, and you can hit up in the chat if you want to, but I want to ask the audience a question just to start. Does anybody recognize the image that's kind of center left of the Funketeers and that flag? Does anybody recognize that? I'm just curious. I don't know if anybody knows that. Yeah, I'm opening the chat so I can see. I don't see any responses right now. All right, so that image is a reimagining of the very iconic photograph taken in World War II of United States Marines during the Battle of Iwo Jima in World War II. So the United States was about to defeat the Japanese, push them off the island, and a group of Marines grabbed the American flag and planted it on a hillside to signal the pending American victory. So George Clinton and his Funketeers kind of appropriated that symbol, but reimagined it. And it's very, very powerful because what the image suggests with the flag, with the colors red, black, and green, with the white letters R&B superimposed on it, that's the Black Liberation flag. And so the art, what the artists are telling us is that, freedom really is just around the corner. And for many adults, and this is something that is very important, and I talk about this all the time in hip hop class, that there are differences between adults how adults might view the world and how young people might view the world. And it's important to keep in mind, even though George Clinton at this point is still a relatively young man, Funkadelic didn't have a hit until he was 35. So we're talking about a guy well into his 30s, looking at the United States in 1978 and feeling like freedom was right around the corner. And this is really significant because that doesn't speak for everyone. In the Black community, doesn't speak for everyone in the brown communities, Latinx communities, immigrant communities at the time, because this is the same social milieu out of which hip hop grew. And hip hop is much less optimistic and much more skeptical, you might say, as an art form. And we'll get into that a little bit later. But one of the things that I just wanted to mention, not just about the lyrics of the song, but the way that the artist that they hired to do this album cover and the way that they saw themselves in this kind of very optimistic position where America was changing. So I'd like to just let you know that the way that this is going to flow, I want to do just a brief introduction and then get into the blog post that I wrote about the Breonna Taylor George Floyd summer and its significance, what that summer really meant. Not so much what the blog post is, just me recording what I could see, but that summer really was very, very important and still resonates with us. Secondly, then I want to talk about the backlash to that summer and the backlash to Black Lives Matter and to the movements for social justice as they manifest themselves in lots of different ways. And then at the end, I want to talk about the challenge to us as we move forward, particularly to young people, and how we hope that you will be inspired to continue this fight. So let me start by talking just a little bit about Parliament Funkadelic. Again, it's a shame I couldn't get the music going because I love the song, but they were definitely one of the greatest funk bands of the 1970s. And Funkadelic, really, George Clinton founded this group as a doo-wop singing group. They were called the Parliaments, but they could never, ever match, say, the Temptations or the Four Tops, so they went in a slightly different direction. The group Parliament then was reimagined as a kind of R&B funk dance group, and then Funkadelic was supposed to be kind of the psychedelic rock version of that. And continuing the long tradition, those people who know the music of rock and roll, I mean, the origins of rock and roll grow out of Black America. This is Black music. Even though now we don't think of Black people playing rock and roll, that's how it started. And Clinton very much saw himself and his group trying to continue that legacy, which sadly was kind of interrupted, but was reignited with the emergence of artists like Fishbone, Mother's Finest, and then eventually Prince. And that continued from there into Living Color and other groups that we have with us through the 80s and 90s. When we think about Parliament Funkadelic, it's also important to kind of situate them where they were in the world of hip hop, I mean, not hip hop, but in the world of R&B and pop music and funk. They were largely this rival to or the opposite of Earth, Wind & Fire. And many people look at Earth, Wind & Fire kind of as the standard bearers, and there's no doubt Earth, Wind & Fire was comprised of master musicians. But Parliament Funkadelic also had great musicians too. And the differences largely were around not only the type of music played, but the art that they created, both lyrically as well as visually. And so the theatrics of Earth, Wind, and Fire were around pyramids and ancient Egypt, and a lot of it was about uplift and these strong messages of hope and power, also very optimistic music. Whereas P-Funk kind of buried its messages in the party. They didn't want to have very overtly social political messages like keep your head to the sky or you're a shining star or serpentine fire, anything like that. So they just are about the party, but they would often put their messages, kind of bury their messages underneath these party lyrics. So it didn't quite come out as dramatically as some of the Earth, Wind & Fire songs. And this was deliberate on George Clinton's part, because having been in the music industry as long as he'd been in, at least if you trust his autobiography, and there are certainly reasons not to trust it, but if you trust his autobiography, then George was very clear in saying that he didn't think a band could last long with very overtly political lyrics, and that if you really wanted to make an impact on people, you got to kind of toe this line between what he called the bubblegum, you know, kids that are 12 to 16 years old, we're going to buy music and dance to it. And then the older adult, older teens or young adults who wanted a party, but had, you know, a more mature vision of the world, that if you could get everybody dancing and partying, then you could give them messages about what was going on. And there were definitely messages in Funkadelic's music. I mean, there's no question that they were here. And so I want to kind of walk through, if I could stop sharing the PowerPoint and go to my blog. There were very clear messages that they articulated, and many of them I wrote about in this particular piece. So I'll read this. This is from June 12, 2020. One Nation Under a Social Justice Groove. During a national holiday that was started by Black folks, police killed George Floyd on a Minneapolis street. It seemed like just the day before, Louisville police killed Breonna Taylor, a Black first responder whose mother was scared she might die from coronavirus, in her own apartment during a botched drug raid. And more recently, a white woman walking her unleashed dog in the ramble of Central Park called the NYPD on a Black man and claimed that he was threatening her because he had the audacity to tell her to put a leash on the dog as per park rules. In spite of my sadness and trauma fatigue, the responses on the streets of our cities and on social media give me hope. Our current president made it clear from inception that he was determined to make America great again for a discrete plurality of people. In the midst of a global pandemic, and the objectively incompetent failed approach of the American hunter there too, Trump's fascistas condemned leaders who were trying to safeguard the larger public, ridicule workers unwilling to sacrifice their lives for money, and spit in the faces of other Americans, literally. Here's a chance to dance our way out of our constrictions, George Clinton sang on the iconic song, One Nation Under a Groove. Clearly, the Trump fascistas don't care about the 100,000 Americans who have died from COVID-19. So you know they don't think that Black lives matter. Consequently, it is down to us to remind them and ourselves that our lives and the lives of so many others have inherent value. The same constituencies who tell people of color to take personal responsibility are completely unwilling to hold their leader accountable for his wanton malevolence and unwilling to bear even the slightest discomfort that the rest of us are willing to in order to stop the spread of a postmodern disease. The same groups who claim to be pro-life don't care about the new spike of the historical plague that kills Black and Latinx folks like Ahmaud Arbery, gonna be freaking up and down hang up alleyway. Those folks gripped by white supremacy won't stop the massacre because it's too much fun. It gives them too much meaning. And to celebrate their freedom, these fascistas are unwittingly forging a suicide pact through pool parties and large gatherings. With the groove our only guide, we should all be moved. Feet don't fail me now. Because they are blinded by their privileges, it is down to us to reveal to them again that white supremacy kills everything, even white folks. Yep, the same people who don't want scientists and experts telling them what to do with their bodies are adamant about telling a woman what to do with hers. The same folks who don't want to be socially distant are determined to distance immigrant children from their families and rip apart LGBTQI love. Republican governors are actively disappearing the actual death tallies in the same way that they have tried to disappear Black, Brown, Left, and youth voting power. And in spite of all the evidence of the racial disparities in the infection and death rates in the US, these folks are happy to slaughter someone else's mother, father, or child on the altar of the economy. So when I see the multiracial protesters in the streets typing on Twitter or speaking on Instagram, I can't help but think, ready or not, here we come, getting down on the one which we believe in. Maybe a silver lining of this pandemic is that it has fully ripped the garish mask off capitalism. It has strained the credibility of white supremacy to the breaking point. And since we know that Joe Biden will not save us, it is down to us to make the nation anew, a community that actually takes care of each other. Do you promise to funk? Do you promise to funk the whole funk and nothing but the funk? I'm not suggesting that anyone do any particular thing, because there are so very many things that need to be done. But I am suggesting that we make a commitment to each other to acknowledge the ugly truth of what America is, so that we can make America into what we want it to be. So wide you can't get around it, so low you can't get under it, so high you can't get over it. Sing, children. So that was the blog post that I wrote and published on the website Blurty Report. You can go on Blurty Report and find other writings that I have up there. And for many of us who write for Blurty Report, it was a very active summer. So there are other writings, if you're ever interested, that you can check out. So let me start with the idea around the pandemic. Oops, and I moved one slide too fast. What was so fascinating about that summer and around social justice is that so many ideas collided. So the epidemic of COVID-19 intersected with this epidemic of state and white vigilante violence against Black and brown bodies. And so that really created something really sort of novel, even though these problems are very old. And because of that novelty, I think there was a chance to really perhaps say something different. And what was clear, I think, both through the leadership of Donald Trump, or lack of leadership throughout his administration, but all the various people that emerged from the far right during that period, and even before, you know, in reaction to President Obama, for example, what was really clear was that whiteness as a concept, as a social construct, is really fragile, and it requires constant defense. It requires constant reinforcement. And as such, it's a socially constructed force that can be undone. And so part of the protest, to me, part of the significance of the protest was reinforcing that very idea. Now, what was interesting, one of the things that was interesting to me was that in the middle of this pandemic, none of the protests that I heard about appeared to be turned into super spreader events. There are certain events that definitely became super spreader events, like the biker rally in Sturgis, South Dakota, and people going there and hanging out and then taking COVID with them all across the country. And you didn't hear the same about the protests, whether they were in New York or in Philadelphia, where my son was active, or here in Long Island, where I live, my wife and I and our youngest daughter, where we went to rallies and protests. You didn't, you know, people were not leaving those and coming down with COVID. And so I found that really, really fascinating. And again, for the larger audience, and I don't know if people want to respond in the chat, and I want to thank Terrence for his message in the chat. Thank you very much. What did you see? Did you participate in one of the rallies? And if you did, what did you see? Because I saw a number of things, some quite remarkable and uplifting, and then other things quite disturbing, which hopefully I'll get into when we get to the backlash. One thought that occurred to me was that infection rates were very, very low at these rallies, because so much of the rally was about giving voice to the voiceless. And in some ways, by just allowing oppressed people, whomever you are, however you're marginalized, having the chance to talk, to express yourself, is almost a form of self-care and healing. And so it may have been just this act of speaking truth to power protected us or inoculated us, however temporarily, to COVID. But I also think it's because when I went to these protests, everybody was masked up. Now, people weren't necessarily social distancing, but folks weren't as crowded in or packed in as tightly as possible. That's right, Latour. I think love might have a lot to do with this, that the infection rates were so low. I also think that it could be because the protests themselves reflect so much out of the civil rights movement. And on the one hand, they reflect the ability to recreate Martin Luther King's beloved community. One of the most radical things that King talked about And make no mistake, King was radical. Even if you believe in nonviolence, he was very radical. And we can talk about that in the Q&A if you'd like. But one of those things that he really stressed was the fact that the challenge for us is to create a beloved community, not centered around a Christian identity, but just human identity, where Christians and Jews and Muslims and Hindus and Jains and Sikhs and Buddhists can all gather. Everyone from all the faith communities can come together and we would take care of each other. And as someone just said in the chat, there was also the added element that we were outside. So we were not protesting indoors, which I think is also significant in a lot of other ways too. Even though the protest did tap into that, say, nonviolent civil disobedience focus on creating the beloved community, it also tapped into a rhetorical bluntness of protest that we'd seen before. And the revolutionary demands in 2020 kind of echoed what we heard from Malcolm X or even Fannie Lou Hamer. Now, Fannie Lou Hamer, I think this may be controversial. A lot of people put her on the Martin Luther King side because she did not advocate violence, but she advocated political power for Black people. And that's Black power. So I put them together. I see her in this overlap between the two segments of the civil rights movement. And I think a lot of what people were speaking about and protesting kind of reflected her sentiment as well. And I think the inclusive nature of the direct action campaigns, those protests, signaled an understanding that everyone's fate was linked. And so it was important for all of us to come together. Now, the backlash that takes place is as old as the nation itself. And so anytime Black or brown people or other oppressed people have protested, there's always been a backlash. So it was nothing new. And the backlash began right alongside the protest. They continue today. And I just wanted to outline a little bit of how that works. So at the time, the protest that we went to was in Mineola, which was the seat of government for Nassau County in Long Island. And when we went to the protest and everybody's there nonviolently, I didn't see anybody who was armed with any weapons at all. We were met with a large police presence in the street, kind of cordoning us off and then, you know, kind of funneling us into the courtyard in front of the courthouse. There were drones flying overhead, I think, taking pictures of everyone in the crowd. There were spotters, if not snipers, on the tops of the building, the courthouse, as well as the building behind us or east of us. And so it would have been easy to feel intimidated, but in that crowd and the beauty of the crowd and the urgency of the moment, many of us did not. But that was a clear sign of backlash because it criminalized this protest and suggested that, that this was not a protest to be taken seriously. This was not a matter of citizens engaging in their free speech rights and in legitimate political discourse, but this was somehow threatening. But the backlash also occurred in terms of, say, reactions to protests that are overwhelmingly white, like the January 6th insurrection, which really isn't even a protest, or the reactions now to the trucker convoy that the White House has decided to deploy National Guardsmen around DC as the trucker convoy that's anti-vax and anti-mandate, vaccine mandate and mask mandate makes its way toward DC, but these National Guardsmen are supposed to be unarmed. So it's a completely different response to the response of Black and brown and particularly young people going out in the streets in the summer of 2020. The backlash continued at the time in the ways in which George Floyd and Ahmaud Arbery, particularly much more so than Breonna Taylor, were kind of slandered or defamed in the press. As many of their family members have talked about, it's like they've been killed twice, like they've been killed once physically, and then their character, their reputation gets murdered again. This is part of the backlash. And in spite of the successful rulings that we've seen recently in the Floyd trial and the Arbery case, which I do think are important. So please don't mistake my skepticism or criticism for thinking they're not important because they are. But on the whole, I'm still worried that to a large extent, For most of our fellow citizens, Black lives do not matter. Brown lives do not matter. And so the fight continues. And much of this is kind of crystallized in Trump's big lie, both in terms of the eagerness to slander victims of police or vigilante violence, whether it was, you know, showing these images of Ahmaud Arbery walking into an unfinished house and saying, well, we thought he was a thief. And I don't know if you remember in the whole buildup to the trial, there were multiple videos of multiple white people walking through the same unfinished structure. And yet no one assumed that they were thieves. No one assumed that they were there to do some kind of harm. And just the fact of walking through indicated that he was some type of criminal. And this is important because I've heard people, you know, say it to my face to tell me, well, George Floyd, passed a counterfeit $20 bill, or Eric Garner was selling loose cigarettes on the street, or, you know, Ahmaud Arbery stole something out of the house. And what's important here is that the people that say that clearly indicate that they don't believe in democracy, that they believe in fascism. Because one of the central principles of our criminal justice system and our democracy is that you are innocent until proven guilty. And so to simply slander and defame people based on some crime and say, well, they must have been guilty of something so they got what they deserved, tells me that you're not really interested in civil liberties. The criminalizing of the protest of people of color and their white allies, voter suppression, and even the insane rhetoric around critical race theory, kind of all point to this backlash. And as a former lawyer and law student, I actually learned from people who created critical race theory. So I'd be happy to talk to you about it in the Q&A and talk about why it's not a problem, why it's not an issue, and people who are afraid of it spreading everywhere are incredibly wrong, and deliberately so, I think. So there are all these aspects of the backlash that are important, and the challenge for us is, you know, what are we going to do about it? And as Leslie suggests, yes, the verdicts should not stand out. They should be normalized. And that's the problem, is that they stand out as so weird and unusual, precisely because so few people have ever been convicted. And as Terrence suggested, yes, the claim somehow that the January 6th insurrection was peaceful, constitutionally protected speech is insane. It's absolutely insane. So, yes, I again agree with another comment that Terrence put in the chat. Now, since we're starting to run a little short on time, I wanted to stop my PowerPoint and go to see if I can find this music, because I wanted to share with you, just as a contrast, one of the more recent hip hop songs that I like a lot and like to talk about in my classes. Hopefully I'll get this to play. Now, Earth Gang is a group based in Atlanta, and I'm a big fan of a lot of Southern rap, in part because I am a Southerner. And so many people, when you hear art that, you know, I've spent, even though I grew up in Tennessee, I spent a lot of time in Atlanta, Birmingham, Nashville. So it's easy to visualize these places as an artist is rapping. And one of the important things, or significant things, of course, about rap music is that at the first cut, it is lyrical. And so when I teach about the rap, one of the things, if you take the art seriously, then you have to listen to what the artist is saying. And I think that there's a lot to be said that's being said in this particular song that's kind of amazing. The other thing I should add is that I'm gonna be 60 years old tomorrow. And I say that because I don't go clubbing. I don't hang out on corners. I don't have a boombox on my shoulder. So I learned this music, or I learned these new artists by, you know, talking with my kids, talking with my students. And so I try to, you know, figure them out and see what they're saying. And so Earth Gang, I've kind of gravitated to in part because I think they do some really interesting stuff. And if you get a chance to see their video Meditate, that's also a really powerful kind of indictment of Trump's America. They even have like a baby dressed up as Trump trying to build a wall with little bricks. I mean, it's really, it's kind of funny, but it's also, I think, kind of profound. So this group, I think, does some really interesting things. The lyrics, of course, call us to be hypervigilant and to pay attention to where we are, which is always important as we're trying to survive. But I think the art, as well as the lyrics, tell us a lot. And the art from the video speaks to at least three different topics, the question of identity, as well as the question of power, and then finally a call to action. So the question of identity is, you know, kind of simple, but also very complex. I mean, questions like, who are you? Or where are you? What makes you you? And you look at the video, the center of the video is built around four young men, probably young teenagers, by their dress, by their bicycles. You look at them and say, those are working class kids. And so there's a strong sense of who they are that you get in the video. And just the trees in the background as well gives you the sense of this being somewhere in the South where, you know, you're going to have neighborhoods abutted by trees and many forests. I mean, I remember that growing up. So this looks very familiar to me and what I grew up with. Really significantly is the question of power, because in the terms of identity and identifying the central characters in the video, you'll notice that all of them are young and they're riding bikes on paved roads that are made for cars. So it reinforces this idea that they're vulnerable. All of them are vulnerable. And even if you didn't get it right away, there's the close-up of the young man who has the long hair and the black t-shirt on. He's got a cast on his arm. And on the arm, of course, is written the title of the video, Swivel. But the cast, you know, signifies, you know, his arm is broken. He might be in pain. So again, vulnerable. He's vulnerable. But what's significant here, even though they have very little power, they still have agency. And this is part of what Swivel is suggesting, is that you still, even if you don't have a whole lot of power, you do have the ability to try and control what happens to you, what happens to your loved ones, what happens to your community. Even if you're relatively distant from the sources of power, you say in city government or state government or the federal government, or that you still can do something. All right. Sometimes that something might be those kids escaping the guy who was stabbing to death some unknown person. So that escape is taking, you know, is taking action, is engaging in power. And of course, the most dramatic display of that was, again, the kid with the long hair and the black t-shirt grabbing a gun and putting it in his backpack to protect himself. All right. Which leads us to the third and final thing, which is the call to action, that the video, unlike a lot of videos lately, an artist who just want people to dance or go out and buy expensive clothes and jewelry and, you know, be dripping and all that kind of stuff or whatever it is. I can't remember how the young folks say it now. But instead, this video suggests a call to action. That, again, even though you don't have a lot of power, you can do what you can to protect yourself, much like Mobb Deep with Dwick. Do what you can, kid. So you do what you can. Call to action, whether that's direct action protests or boycotts or teach-ins or participating by voting. Or even if you decide, I want to create policy, you can do that. Or run for office, you can do that. All of you can do this. And this is important and doesn't get reinforced enough how young many of these people that we think of heroes were at the time. When the Montgomery bus boycott started, Martin Luther King was 26 years old. The Black Panthers were started by college students. SNCC, as the name implies, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, was started by college students. So all of these people were young, and they responded to the call to action in their time. Here's just a couple of images of some people that I admire and responded to this call in different ways. On the left is Constance Baker Motley. Constance Baker Motley is one of the unsung heroes of the lawsuits against racial segregation. So she worked hand in hand with Thurgood Marshall and Spotswood Robinson as they're filing lawsuits across the South trying to end racial segregation. So she responded to the call as an immigrant, a child of immigrants. She's Afro-Caribbean. Her parents came from Nevis. And she responded to the call by getting an education, going to law school, and using the law to fight for social justice. On the right, at the top, is Erica Huggins, and then at the bottom, Elaine Brown, both sisters who were in the Black Panther Party, but who have gone on to do other things. At the time that the party started in 67, 68, 69, Erica was living in Oakland and helped start the free schools. And even after her trial for murder, where she was acquitted, she went in New Haven, she went back to Oakland and started what was the precursor of charter schools, creating a completely independent school in Oakland for poor Black and brown kids in the community where she lived. And that school still exists today, Merritt College. And it's an amazing testament to what could be done, but people can build out of nothing. And then Elaine Brown, who was the last kind of chairperson of the party after Huey P. Newton was thrown in jail, she continued to run the party. And then after the party collapsed, she continued to be an activist. And today is a criminal justice activist. A lot of her work has been focused on this idea of abolishing prisons and abolishing the police altogether. Personally, I admire her and her courage. I'm not a proponent of abolition, not because I don't think it's a good idea, but because I think we're not ready yet. But again, we can talk about this in the Q&A. So finally, to kind of wrap up, when I'm thinking about the groove from One Nation Under a Groove, I think that the groove that is guiding us is the heartbeat of people who are marginalized, whether you're marginalized because of race or gender, because of sexual orientation, because of citizenship status. It's that heartbeat that's propelling all of us. And that groove provides us with a vision for a different type of America. And so the call to action is to continue to try and build that different type of America. As I mentioned earlier, young people have always been instrumental in pushing for that different America. So that this is this call that you know, Dr. Yates is issuing now and this program is issuing now, this is not new. This is not new. We've been doing this for a long time and young people have always responded. And the different America that we want to build will require a great deal of work. But I want you to feel heartened that you can contribute to this by doing whatever it is that you do. So even though no one can do everything, everybody can do something. Everybody can do something. And maybe your best political work is graduating from college. So I wanted to leave you with this, the words of one of my favorite poets, Audre Lorde, who said, "And when we speak, we are afraid. Our words will not be heard nor welcomed, but when we are silent, we are still afraid. So it is better to speak, remembering we were never meant to survive." Thank you very much.
I think we can give a clap, like a clap for Brother Dr. White. I truly appreciate that. And Dr. White, if I think I may not be able to share my screen is short, but we've talked about One Nation Under Groove so much that I think it's like we got to have a little piece of it. Give me one second. Hi. All right. I wanted to give a little bit of it because it's so, first of all, just profound. And I really appreciate the connection, the history, and the call to action of where we got to go and how we can move forward. But thank you for this, Dr. White. I got kicked out for a moment. I've been fighting to get back in, but I'm back in. So I want to value everyone's time, and especially yours, Dr. White. So I want to first take a moment and just say thank you, Dr. White, for coming to the campus. Virtually, when things are a lot better, we would love, you have an invitation anytime you want to come on campus, teach a class, like, come in, let's do it. Like, let's set up a lecture. Let's set up some things for our students to be involved with you as much as possible. So as we end out, I just want to simply thank all of the team for student development and enrollment management, the enrollment services, like just really the team to make sure that this thing could happen. And with technical glitches and all, we were able to get it off and make it a great program. So as I say goodbye to everyone, just know that each month you will continue to see programming that's coming out of student development and enrollment management. So again, thank you, everyone. Have a great day. And I look forward to